Hare Krishna. Hey, some of you can come ahead a little bit if more devotees come afterwards. Hare Krishna. Thank you for coming today evening. And I'll speak on Bhagavad Gita 18.58. I'll speak on the topic of, we often talk about how we need to have faith in Krishna. But I'll talk about how Krishna has faith in our potential. So let us have faith in his potency. Krishna has faith in our potential. Let us have faith in his potency. So 18.58 in the Bhagavad Gita states, Machittaha sarva durgani mat prasadat tarishyasi athachetva mahankaran nashoshyasi vinangshasi. Krishna says, Machittaha, if you become conscious of me, sarva durgani, all obstacles, mat prasadat tarishyasi, by my grace you will be able to cross over them. Athachetva mahankaran, if out of ego, however, na shroshyasi, you do not hear me, vinangshasi, you will be lost. So Krishna is telling very clearly here the benefit of becoming conscious of him. Now the relationship between us and Krishna is eternal, at the same time it is not eternally realized. Krishna is always present in our heart. He's in the hearts of each one of us. But just because Krishna is in our heart does not mean that he is in our consciousness. Our conscious awareness goes towards many things. So right now, in this room, there are so many things. But that we may not be conscious of those things. There may be people also over here. We meet, we just glance at people, we greet them if we know them. But sometimes there might be someone who we may not even notice. So our conscious awareness is like our energy. It is like a light. The adityagatam tejo. Just as the sun gives light to the whole universe. Similarly, the consciousness is illuminated. Consciousness illuminates for us so that we can observe and act. But what we are conscious of is up to us. And we may come to a temple, but if we are coming to the temple and say we have had some negative interaction with some devotee and we are very tense or angry or upset with that devotee, and then we may come to the temple, but we may not be conscious of that Krishna is present in the temple, we may be thinking, oh, is this person going to be there? If that person is there, then you will feel so tense. We'll feel annoyed. So we'll be more conscious of that person than of Krishna also. So basically, where our consciousness goes, it is determined by our attachment and our aversion. Raga and Dvesha. So for example, some child likes Lego toys. As soon as they come to some home, the first thing they look, are there any toys over here? There will be many other things in the house. They just look first at the toys. What can I play with? So that's what they are attached to. That's what they will look at. So our consciousness, so if we consider the consciousness to be like a torch, that it's like a torch is giving light. A torch, we focus on different things at different times. So if I want to look at you, it's dark, say, then I'll take the torch, I'll focus on you. They're like, who is this person who is here? I'll try to identify them. Now, similarly for us, our consciousness is like a torch. And we are meant to focus it on those things that will help us concentrate. But this torch, suppose we are having a torch with us, and so suppose somebody else is also there with us, say you have your torch, but there is a friend with you, and that friend keeps shaking your hands. So when the friend shakes the hands, you are trying to look here, but the friend moves the hand here. And you see, suddenly see things over there. You can't see what you want to see. And then you want to see in this direction and you move the hand in that direction, but that friend comes and shakes the hand. So basically, if it's our torch, But if the torch is not in our control, then we'll not be able to see things properly. So our consciousness is like our torch. And it is meant to be under our control. We direct it. This is what I want to be conscious of. But in between us and this torch, let's say our consciousness is our mind. And the mind keeps shaking us consciousness, keeps shaking our focus. So you want to think about one thing, you want to focus on one thing, but suddenly some other thought comes up. Our consciousness goes in that direction. So we might be, say, studying Shastra, and suddenly I have to do this work. You know, when I came home, did I lock the car properly or not? If I not lock the car, then what? I have to go and check it immediately. So what happens is, we may get distracted because this mind keeps popping up many, many thoughts within us. So now, when especially we want to do something which requires attention, which is difficult, which requires concentration, sustained concentration, say we want to study for a difficult exam, that we require to focus in a sustained way. And at that time, that focus can become very difficult because the mind will be restless. And what does the mind do when it is restless, at least with respect to a torch? The torch, we know, okay, somebody is here, but my torch has gone in this direction, so I can't see properly. But I know somebody is here. But with respect to the mind, it doesn't just shake our consciousness, get it disfocused, but it also distorts our vision. It also makes us believe things which are not for real. That means, whenever we try to do something new, I remember first time, maybe 30 years ago or something, I gave my first public talk. It was even before I was introduced to Krishna consciousness. I was in college, school college at that time. So when I gave that, I went on the stage and started speaking, and I had a full talk, rehearsed, memorized, everything prepared. But as soon as I went on the stage, it was almost as if something spoke to me, and I could hear that voice louder than the voice of the people around me. He says, "You are going to make a mess of yourself. You are going to make a fool of yourself." And then, it was such a real voice. Hey, where did his voice come from? And I just tried to neglect it, and I continued speaking. But then, what happens for me in general is that if I am not prepared very well for a talk, I tend to speak fast. And so I started speaking, and I started speaking fast. So from my childhood, I used to like English. So my English was, I used to use such words that people don't use commonly. So what happened when I start speaking fast and I start using unusual words? So people start becoming restless. They can't understand what is going on. It's like, suppose you get into a car, and then before we can even put on the seat belt, suddenly the car starts moving at 80. Hey, what happened? So I just got on the stage and started speaking like a super fast express. And then as people started getting distracted, I started thinking, why are people not paying attention? And I started speaking faster. And I was supposed to speak for 7 minutes, and I finished my talk in 3 minutes. So that was a time when it struck me, what was this? I was fully prepared and I had rehearsed also many times. But you are going to make a fool of yourself. I mean, what is this voice? Where does this voice come from? So I never understood. I knew there's something within us which works against us. But what is that? Then many years later, when I read the Bhagavad Gita, then I understood, whose voice is this? Consciousness, yes. The mind, yes. It is the mind's voice. The mind always keeps distracting us, discouraging us, diverting us. And in this way, the mind works against our best interests. The mind often, it can work in two ways. Sometimes it makes us more confident than we need to be. It can make us overconfident or it can make us diffident. Overconfident means, say, somebody doesn't know driving at all. And he said, no problem, I can drive. And somebody never driven a car, they say, I'll get in the car and drive. What? I've seen many people drive, no problem. And you take a car and start driving, lead to disaster. So the mind can sometimes make us more confident than we should be. But sometimes the mind can make us less confident than what we need to be also. And especially when we are doing something challenging, if we try it once, twice, it doesn't work, it won't happen. It won't happen. And we just give it up. So, I was talking with one person. He had been practicing bhakti earlier. And now he had given up the practice of bhakti. So we were friends earlier. So I asked him, what happened? He said, you given up the practice of bhakti? He said, no, I have not given it up. I only postponed it to my next lifetime. So I asked him, why did you postpone it to the next lifetime? So he said, actually, when I try to chant Hare Krishna, he says, my mind wanders everywhere. I feel those 2 hours of chanting, I'm simply wasting my time. So I felt that maybe I can use the time constructively. In this, I'll do some punya in this lifetime. The next lifetime, my mind will be more controlled. Then I'll practice bhakti. So I was saying that, so you are not chanting because you're saying that your mind is not controlled. He said, yes. But then, when you give up your chanting, what are you doing? No, I'm just giving up chanting. He said, no. I said, when you're giving up chanting, you are actually further giving yourself to the control of the mind. It is your mind which is telling you don't chant. Isn't it? So if we want to control the mind, if we give further control to the mind, how are we going to control the mind? It is, for us, we have to have that inner tussle that is required if you want to do anything constructive. So by giving control to someone, we are never going to get control. If somebody is riding a horse, and that horse is very wild, and you're trying to control the horse, rein in the horse, and get it to move in the right direction, and the horse is very forceful and is just moving off in the wrong direction. And if somebody says, okay, you know, now the horse is wild, I'll just let the horse go where it wants, then afterwards I'll control it. Well, for all the journey, when you let the horse go, it can go anywhere. It can go anywhere. The nature of the mind is that it will always keep us dissatisfied. It will always keep us dissatisfied. No matter what we do. If you are practicing spiritual life, the mind will say, hey, the spiritual life is very difficult. Don't do this. Then we start getting materialistic, the mind will say, hey, you're being too materialistic, you know, don't do this. I say, then what should I do? I say, mind will say, try this out. And then eventually, whatever we do, the mind will keep us dissatisfied. What do you want me to do? If we ask the mind, you say, I only want one thing. I want to keep you dissatisfied. The mind is such a thing, even if we go to paradise, where everything is wonderful, the mind will say, yes, but... So whatever happens in our life, the mind will keep us always dissatisfied. That's why if we keep listening to our mind, if the horse is out of control, then we have to fight to get the horse in control. If we let the horse go further out of control, then the horse gets the habit of being in control. And the more the horse gets the habit of being in control, the less it will ever come under control. So of course, we want to work with the horse. We don't want to control the horse so much, we don't want to beat the horse to death. We want to work with the horse. So the horse has energy, and that energy needs to be directed constructively. So with respect to the mind, the mind is like the horse. If it's a long distance we have to go and we don't have any other transportation, the horse is what we need to use. So we need to properly manage the horse so that we can get to the destination. Similarly, with respect to our practice of our practice of spiritual life or for our doing anything in life. Actually, the mind is a vital tool because we perceive the world through the mind. But if the mind gets distorted, if the mind distorts our perception, then we can't see things properly, we can't act properly. So that means we need the mind, but we don't need to be controlled by the mind. We need to work with the mind. So when a rider is riding a horse, the rider doesn't work, rider doesn't go where the horse wants to go. The rider doesn't either go against where the horse wants to go. The rider goes where they want to go. So we don't work for the mind, we don't work against the mind. We work with the mind for Krishna. Work for the mind means whatever the mind says, do this, do this, do this, do this, we start doing that. Work against the mind means, the mind says, do this, I'll exactly do the opposite. That will be torture. We can't keep doing things that we dislike. But the problem with doing the things that we like only all the time is that when we keep doing, if we keep doing whatever we like, we end up disliking ourselves. If we keep doing whatever we like, we end up disliking ourselves. Suppose with respect to food, somebody keeps just eating whatever food they like. Then eventually, what will happen is that their health will get spoiled and they will become very obese. And then they'll think, what is this? You know, I have no control. Why am I like this? You'll dislike yourself. If we are sitting and reading something on a computer, but then the mind says, come on, you know, read this. This news looks interesting. Read this. And then we read one news. Whenever you read one article, there are 10 other links of related content. And you read that. Then there's one video over there. Then you go to the video. And as soon as you see one video, there are 10 or 15 or 20 other videos over there. And if you keep clicking whatever we like, then 4, 5, 6 hours may go. And then after that, we'll feel, hey, what a fool I am. I wasted my time. So in general, if we keep doing whatever we like, we end up disliking ourselves. Many people nowadays face self-esteem issues. And they face self-esteem issues not so much because they don't have abilities. It is not that they don't have talent, but actually from talent to achievement, the journey from talent to achievement requires commitment. Even if somebody has great talent, unless they are disciplined, they are committed, they cannot go from, the talent won't translate into achievement. So what happens when we keep doing whatever the mind likes, then there is no commitment to anything. And because there is no commitment, then there is no achievement. And if there is no achievement, then the person starts feeling, I am worthless, I am good for nothing. Arjuna became a top archer because, not just because he was talented, yes, he was phenomenally talented, but also he was phenomenally committed. But all day he would hear attentively whenever Drona would be teaching anything. And then all night practically, he would be practicing those archery skills. So by being talented and by being committed, he became an achiever. But when we keep doing whatever our mind tells us to do, we end up disliking ourselves. Now sometimes, we may also understand, you know, why am I so restless? Why am I so restless? 1, 2, 3, 4. Nowadays with gadgets, so much available, many kids especially have this attention deficiency. So attention just goes from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It just goes. So restless. Our attention is like a bird sitting on the perch of a branch. The smallest noise and the bird flies away. So at one moment the bird is there and we just look somewhere. The bird is gone. So like that at one moment, you say we are sitting here attending a class, trying to understand. The next moment, our mind may have gone to the other side of the world also. Just be in India. So our attention is like a bird sitting restlessly on a perch, about to fly away at any moment. So So the mind, so this attention gets distracted by the mind. And how do we get it to focus? That requires commitment. So this is where our faith in Krishna is important, because Krishna has faith in us. Many of us, we feel, oh, I tried to discipline my mind. I tried to commit myself to do things, but it never worked out. Therefore, I just give up. I won't be able to do anything. I just give up. But instead of giving up, we need to look up. Look up means look towards Krishna. What does looking towards Krishna means? Say, suppose somebody wants to become some young person wants to become a cricketer. Now they're dreaming that I want to become the next Sachin Tendulkar or the next Virat Kohli. Now thousands and thousands of players may be aspiring cricketers. But at that time, very few are actually going to become top cricketers. In between that journey of everybody who is trying to achieve something special gets doubts. Will I be able to do it? Will I not be able to do it? But if while they are trying to play cricket and become a good cricketer, if at that time there is some special coach, and then that coach tells, hey, you got talent, you can become a great cricketer, then just that gives so much encouragement to the person, the aspiring cricketer. Oh, this coach said that I have good potential. Almost all people, also sports players who have been phenomenally successful, there have been at least one person in their life who had faith in them. Now, yes, you can be an achiever. Now, actually, at a conscious as well as subconscious level, we are affected by others. If we tell a person that they can be better than what they are, they will become better. Not just by telling, but if you encourage them, inspire them, they will become better. But if we keep telling them, they're good for nothing. If, then that's how they will stay. Of course, the mind can work in the opposite way also. If we keep encouraging someone and the person becomes complacent, I'm already good, I don't have to do anything. That's not good. And sometimes the mind can work. Somebody tells you, they're good for nothing. And how dare you call me good for nothing? I will show you how good I am. So the mind can work in different ways also, but in general, we need someone who has faith in us. So actually, around us there are different people. Some may encourage us, some may discourage us. But beyond them all is Krishna. And Krishna has faith in our potential. How do we know that? That we know from the fact that Krishna never gives up on us. Krishna is always there in our hearts. He never abandons us. And because he never abandons us, that's how we can know that why would he stay with us if he did not have faith that we could do something wonderful, if we could become someone wonderful. We can grow, we can contribute, we can advance. Krishna ultimately wants us to come to him. But even along the journey, Krishna wants us to do wonderful things. Krishna has given us some talents and he wants us to use those talents in his service in various ways. So Krishna has faith in our potential. Now, what is the potential refer to? It can refer to some talents which we have. It can also refer to the commitment that we need to show by which the talent will become achievement. This can apply in our spiritual life also. Say, I want to study Shastra. Now, yes, I have the talent. I can study. I understand concepts. I analyze. But then, we hear some inspiring class. And we say, okay, I'm going to study Shastra. And for 1 week, we study. And after 1 week, then something comes up and we're not able to study for 1 day. That 1 day becomes 2 days. That 2 days become 3 days. And find 1 month, I've not opened Shastra also. And then again, what happened? Again, we may start after some time. So, actually sometimes we feel, I'll never be able to do this. But that feeling is coming from the mind. And if we look at Krishna, instead of looking at the mind, suppose there are two boxers who are fighting. And as the two boxers are fighting, suddenly one boxer just gives a punch. And as the boxer gives a punch, the boxer falls down. The other boxer has fallen down. Now when the other boxer has fallen down, at that time, it's quite discouraging to be knocked down. He's knocked down, not knocked out. But when he's knocked down, at that time, this boxer looks at the opposite boxer. He says, "Hey, you knocked me down. Will I be able to fight and win against you?" Now, if this boxer asks the opposite boxer only, what does the other boxer say? "Never. Give up right now. I've defeated you." If this boxer wants to fight, the boxer should not look at the opponent. The boxer should look at whom? At the coach. He says, "What should I do? Come on, you can do it. Do this, do this." The coach will guide. So when we are discouraged, we have to look at those who will encourage us, not at those who are going to discourage us. So unfortunately for us, it is the mind which distracts us, and the mind which discourages us, the mind which diverts us, and then we ask the mind only, "Will I be able to concentrate ever?" Never. The mind is like that. Chanchalam hi mana Krishna, pramathi balavadudam, tasyaham nigraham manye, vayorivasudushkaram. But instead of looking at the mind, we look at Krishna. Sometimes we think that practicing bhakti means, I have to do this. If I can do this, I chant this many rounds, I do come to the temple, I do this worship, I take this prasad. If I'm doing this, I'm practicing bhakti. Yes, that is true. There are certain external activities which are there in bhakti. But bhakti is much more than that. It's actually an attitude. So if we can't succeed in Krishna consciousness, then we can still fail in Krishna consciousness, not fail out of Krishna consciousness. What does it mean, fail in Krishna consciousness and fail out of Krishna consciousness? Fail in Krishna consciousness means we may decide to do something. Okay, I want to study the Bhagavatam now. And we just start studying for a few days and we can't study. At that time, fail out of Krishna consciousness means think that, "Oh, I'll never be able to study. I just give it up." But fail in Krishna consciousness means, "Krishna, I want to study. I'm not able to study. Please help me. Please help me so that I can manage my time better. I can manage my mind better so that I can focus." So if that inability to do something makes us more dependent on Krishna, makes us turn towards Krishna more, then actually that is making us Krishna conscious. The purpose of studying the Bhagavatam is to become conscious of Krishna. And if inability to study the Bhagavatam also makes us more conscious of Krishna, then actually we are Krishna conscious. Krishna consciousness is not just a set of activities, it is actually a level of consciousness. And if we have that level, then we are growing spiritually. So Krishna has faith in our potential. That means even if we are not able to do something, Krishna doesn't tell us to go away. Krishna doesn't abandon us. Krishna stays with us. So we need to have faith in His potency. Faith in His potency means that even if my mind is super distracted right now, but Krishna has the capacity to control my mind, even if I don't have. That Krishna can help me overcome all my conditionings. Even if I have some external difficulties in my life, Krishna can help me to overcome those difficulties. It is that faith that enables a devotee to move straight towards Krishna. In the Mahabharata, on the 13th day in the Kurukshetra war, the Kauravas diabolically conspired together, and six of them came together. And they killed one of the foremost Pandava warriors. Who was that? Yes, Abhimanyu. And that night, when Arjuna came back, he was shocked, he was shattered. And then he was infuriated. When he heard about how six of them had come together to kill him, he said that wicked Jayadrath, the Pandavas had a full plan. Abhimanyu was going to go into the Kaurava ranks, the Chakravyuha, and then the other Pandavas were going to follow him. But Jayadrath had blocked him. So Arjuna felt it was Jayadrath who was responsible, the prime person for the killing of Abhimanyu, because Jayadrath cut Abhimanyu off from those who could have assisted him, those who could have protected him. So he said that by tomorrow sunset, I will kill Jayadrath or I will enter into fire. And when Arjuna took this vow, on the Pandava side, everybody was morose, everybody was shattered. And suddenly, when Arjuna took this vow, everybody became jubilant. The Pandavas started blowing their conches. And in anger, in determination, in a fierce resolve to fight and avenge the death of Abhimanyu. On the other side, the Kauravas were there and they were celebrating. Duryodhana was very happy. He said, Yudhishthira, he said, Drona, well done. No, you got Abhimanyu was a big thorn in our side. He was saying, maybe tomorrow set up another Chakravyuh and we'll catch another warrior tomorrow. So then as they were planning like this, suddenly when the Pandavas blew conches, they blew so fiercely that the sound went across the battlefield. Say, why are the Pandavas blowing their conches? And they all had spies over there. Pandavas had spies with the Kauravas, Kauravas had spies with the Pandavas. Some of the spies came and told Jayadrath. And Jayadrath came running over there. And Jayadrath came running. He said that he was panting, his face was white, his eyes were white, his hair was disheveled. He said, oh Duryodhana, that evil son of Indra, begotten through Kunti, has vowed to kill me by tomorrow sunset. He says, oh, guarantee me my protection or I am going right now to the Himalayas to hide. So now, when Duryodhana heard this, he immediately saw an opportunity. He said that, if we can stop Jayadrath from being killed tomorrow, then Arjuna will die. Arjuna will choose death. And he said, don't worry. We will arrange the whole army to protect you. Jayadrath will never be able to reach you. Isn't it, Drona? Now, Drona was thinking that if Arjuna, he is thinking in his mind, Arjuna alone and angry would be difficult to stop. And he could arrange the army in such a way that he would make it almost impossible for Arjuna to stop, Arjuna to reach Jayadrath. But Arjuna was not alone. Arjuna was with Krishna. And when he was with Krishna, he said that he knew Jayadrath is as good as dead already. So he said, just to pacify him, he said, oh Jayadrath, we will arrange the whole army to protect you. Arjuna will find it very difficult to reach you. And he couldn't resist the bar. Duryodhana said, if he reaches you, Jayadrath started trembling. If he reaches you, actually, there is no shame in dying a hero's death on the battlefield. So Duryodhana said, no, he will never be able to reach you. Don't worry. On the other side then, what happened? After they all took the blow the conches and then they made a plan, they decided that they made some tentative plan, but they knew that everything would depend on how the Kauravas formed their military formation. They said, tomorrow morning we'll observe and then we'll decide. Then as Krishna and Arjuna were going to their tents, so Krishna told to Arjuna and he said, Arjuna, you became impulsive and took a terrible vow. He said, how? Tomorrow it will be very difficult. Drona will stop you from reaching Jayadrath. So Arjuna was, in Hindi use the word bindast. Arjuna was without any fear. When he worries, he said, Krishna, I cannot understand your anxiety. He said, you know my power and I know your power. You know my power, I know your power. So then, both Krishna and Arjuna went and they took rest. And that night, and Krishna was there, Krishna was awake throughout the night. And Arjuna went to sleep. He had a long day of fight. And Krishna got up and in his mind, he he called his charioteer Daruka and told Daruka that, "You keep my chariot ready at the outskirts of the battlefield. If Arjuna is not able to reach Jayadrath, then I will get onto my chariot and I will kill Jayadrath. I will ensure that Arjuna will never die." And Daruka was very touched to see Krishna's determination to protect Arjuna. And after telling this to Daruka, Krishna felt a little relieved. And Krishna came back and saw Arjuna was sleeping. And Krishna said to himself, "Just look at my devotees. Now they put me in anxiety and they go to sleep." So, the next day's fight is a long story. But the next day they started, Arjuna just broke into the Kaurava rank. And he, one after another, whoever came along the way, Arjuna just overpowered them. And the Pandavas had planned their strategy well, so that all the other major Kaurava warriors were engaged with other Pandava warriors. Arjuna just kept going straight inside. And they were wreaking havoc in the Kaurava camp. And as Arjuna was moving inexorably forwards, it's like sometimes if a tsunami wave comes, in the ocean, it doesn't look like a tsunami. It just looks like another wave. In the ocean, it just looks like another wave. But when that tsunami actually comes to the coast, when it meets an obstacle, that's when, how big it is, how much water is there in it, how forceful it is revealed. Otherwise, if a ship is going along in the ocean and a tsunami is there, the ship will rise a little bit, but the ship will come down. The ship will not get swept away. Because the tsunami is, the wave's force is distributed over the distance. But when it hits land, at that point, its onward force is checked. At the same time, when it is hitting the landmass, its force rises. So like that, as Arjuna was charging through the Kaurava ranks, the Kauravas were getting tired. They're just not able to fight them. But Arjuna's strength seemed to be getting stronger and stronger and stronger. And finally, he could see Jayadrath standard. And he could see behind, the sun was quickly going towards the horizon. And he charged forward at full blast. And Duryodhana was shocked. The sheer ferocity of Arjuna's attack had left him stunned. But then he looked at the sun. He had become very disheartened. But he looked at the sun, he saw it so close to the horizon. So he decided, "Yesterday I had 6 warriors attack Abhimanyu. Today I'll have 8 warriors." And he told Drona and Kripa to come from the front. He told Karna and Chalya to come from one side. He told Ashwatthama and Vikarna to come from another side. And he told Ashwatthama and Shakuni to come from one side. And he himself, along with Dushasan, attacked Arjuna from another side. And as all of them attacked Arjuna together, Arjuna became overwhelmed. It's like a shower of arrows coming on him from all sides. They're so thick, like a complete dark cloud. When rains are coming and battering us, that's bad enough. But if the rains are coming through such thick clouds, it becomes completely dark. Then we're not only being battered by the rain, but we're also blinded by the clouds. And then we just can't see or do anything. So at one moment, Arjuna was charging forward. And the next moment, suddenly he found that such a rain of arrows coming towards him, practically couldn't see anything. Arjuna is fighting to his full potential, countering all the arrows with all his energy. But this combined attack was too much even for him to counter. And then Arjuna started despairing. So close and yet so far. At that time, Krishna looked at Arjuna. Krishna looked at the arrows coming ahead. And he realized that Arjuna needs my help. And Krishna decided, Krishna could have immediately called his chariot and Daruka, but he wanted Arjuna to have the credit. So he wanted Arjuna to actually complete his vow, not just to get the vow completed. So what he did? He immediately raised his hand. And while everybody was watching, suddenly the Sudarshan Chakra appeared in front of him. But although they were watching, what happened was everybody was caught in the fight, and the fight was so fierce that the arrows were coming here and there. Nobody noticed Sudarshan was there. Sudarshan appeared on his hands and Krishna hurled it. And Sudarshan just whizzed high into the sky. And it became like a giant orbiting ball. And it was orbiting and covering the sun so quickly that everybody felt as if the sun has set. And as soon as the sun has set, so what happens? The Pandava, the Kaurava started celebrating. Yes, we have won, we have won. And now when they said, we have won, at that time Arjuna became disheartened. Started putting down his bow, disappointed. Krishna told Arjuna in an urgent tone, he said, there is time still, there is time still. He says, put a Brahmastra on your bow and point it towards Jayadrath. Arjuna knew that sometimes when we should ask questions and sometimes we should not ask questions. So, this was a time no questions asked. Whatever Krishna is telling, just let us do it. He had asked a lot of questions before the battle started, when the Bhagavad Gita was going on. But now, no questions. So, he just shot the targeted the arrow where Jayadrath was. And what had happened was, although all these warriors were around him and earlier they had been protecting Jayadrath, now what happened? They had thought we had won the war. And they just lowered their guard. Even Jayadrath lowered his guard. Jayadrath had been hiding behind all these warriors, but he also came out. He had been jeering Arjuna, should I light your funeral pyre now? So then Arjuna took the bow, and before Arjuna shot the arrow, Krishna removed his Sudarshan. And as soon as he removed his Sudarshan, what they saw was the sun was still there. The last few rays were there. And it's right in front of the eyes of everyone. Arjuna's arrow just went whizzing through. It went and it hit Jayadrath on his neck. And Krishna told Arjuna that when you hit the arrow, hit it in such a way that Jayadrath's neck goes all the way to Simant Panchak. And there his father Rudakshatra is performing austerities. Let it fall on his lap. So Rudakshatra knew that. Rudakshatra knew that his son was quite evil and he knew that his son could be killed. So he had done some tapasya to Shiva. And he had got a benediction that anybody who causes my son's head to fall on the ground, that person's head will crack apart. So now Krishna knew this benediction. So what Krishna told Arjuna is, shoot the arrow in such a way that his head will go and fall right on Rudakshatra's lap. Now Rudakshatra was sitting in meditation and he opened his eyes and suddenly saw, hey, it's a skull with blood on it. What is this? Just push it off. And as soon as they pushed it off, the skull fell on the ground. Boom! His skull broke apart. Krishna Bhagavan ki! So in this way, Krishna expertly took Arjuna to victory. So it was not just by Arjuna's talent. When Arjuna took that vow, I'm going to do this, Krishna had faith. And I talked about last point that Krishna had faith, Arjuna, you can do it. And then when Krishna told Arjuna, now get ready to shoot the arrow. Arjuna did not ask any questions. How? Why? How can I do this? So he had faith. And he did what Krishna told him and he knew Krishna has some mystical potency. Krishna arranged for the sun to be hidden. Krishna arranged for the sun to be seen, and in that way he arranged for Arjuna to fulfill his vow. So similarly for us, now we may not have to fight a physical war with anyone, But we all also have to fight against our mind, fight against our senses, fight against difficult conditions in our life. And sometimes it may feel that it's impossible. It's impossible. I can't do this. But if we persevere, we persevere in doing what we are trying to do, then Krishna can work in miraculous ways. Krishna can work in ways that we have no possibility of knowing also. If we do the best we can, Krishna will do the rest. But if we don't do our best, then Krishna is saying that we are not really interested. Then he will not do the rest. Sometimes what happens, we think my best is not good enough, so we don't even do our best. And we start worrying, oh, even if I do the best, so many things are not going to work out. What is the use of doing my best? But rather than worrying about that, machittaha sarvadurgani, Krishna says, become conscious of me. Become conscious of him means that there are two ways we can be conscious of him. One is that we always have to play our part. And while playing our part, if we become discouraged, then we know that Krishna is with us. Krishna has faith in our potential. So we do our best with faith in Krishna. Krishna has faith in my potential, so let me do my best. But in some situations, even when our best seems to be not good enough, at that time also we become conscious of Krishna and we leave the rest to Krishna. Arjuna did his best, he fought to the fullest capacity that he could. But then he left the rest to Arjuna. He left the rest. When he did not know how to reach, Krishna arranged his own miraculous ways. So when we are practicing bhakti or when we are trying to do anything in our life, is difficult and we start feeling discouraged, you know, rather than becoming conscious of the mind, this is the mind telling me, we turn towards Krishna. And returning towards Krishna means maybe we hear some inspiring, encouraging talks, we remember some pastimes where Krishna has helped his devotees. We cultivate a consciousness of Krishna that inspires us to persevere. And then we will get the energy to move on in our lives. So by thus being both, I'll conclude with this point, that our Krishna consciousness has two aspects to it. One is dependence on Krishna and the other is diligence for Krishna. Diligence for Krishna means when there is something in our control to do, we should do it as well as we can. That is our diligence for Krishna. And dependence on Krishna means, so what we can do, we do our best. That is in a mood of service to Krishna. That is our diligence. And what is beyond our control, we leave it to Krishna. That is our dependence. So Arjuna had exhibited diligence in doing all that he could. But still that was not enough, he exhibited dependence. Krishna, what do you want me to do? You want me to do it? I'll just do it. So in that way, through diligence and dependence, we'll find that Krishna will guide us through. No matter what difficulties we may have in our life, we do our part and Krishna will do his part in his own extraordinary ways. Sometimes we think Krishna consciousness only means dependence on Krishna. Or sometimes we think Krishna consciousness means I am doing my best, why is nothing happening? But both are there, diligence for Krishna and dependence on Krishna. And I started giving classes about 20 years ago, 20, 25 years ago, as a Bhagavad Gita student, a Bhagavad Gita teacher, that time we got some guidelines. 10 guidelines we got. How to speak. And the last guideline was, depend on Krishna. But in bracket, but only after you have prepared. So, dependence on Krishna is not an excuse for not having diligence for Krishna. So both go together, and when we do both together, we'll find that Krishna will help us both by our consciousness of doing our best and by our consciousness of leaving the rest to him, that Krishna will help us overcome whatever difficulties we may face. Machittaha sarvadurgani matprasada tarishyasi. If we become conscious of Krishna, he will help us overcome all obstacles by his grace. I'll summarize. I spoke today on the topic of Krishna has faith in our potential. Let us have faith in his potency. So whenever we are trying to do anything difficult in our life, our mind keeps distracting us. So our consciousness is like our torch, which we need to focus so that we can observe and act effectively. But if the torch is distracted, then we can't see clearly. And that distractor is the mind. And this mind is very forceful and very restless. Just keeps distracting us constantly. But if we keep listening to the mind, we become discouraged by it. And if we keep doing whatever we like, we end up disliking ourselves. And at one level, we start disliking ourselves. Like we may overeat and become terribly obese, or we may just keep clicking on whatever link comes up and waste hours and hours, and then beat ourselves up. Why did I waste my time? So we start disliking ourselves and we start losing hope. The mind doesn't only distract us, but the mind also discourages us.